What's up, everyone? Rich Redmond here, Crash Studios, beautiful Nashville, Tennessee, and this is episode 4 of Pick Rich's Brain.
Drummer, percussionist, author, composer, songwriter, producer, professional speaker, actor, Rich Redmond has left his mark on thousands of songs, including over 21 number one hits, over 30 years of been there, done that, wisdom and knowledge in the Nashville music business. This is Pick Rich's Brain.
It just came out of nowhere. Episode 4. Man, wow. We're talking about all things music, motivation, and success. And every good story has a footnote. And this is our footnote today. He's a footnote. He's the forward. This is my first guest on Pick Rich's Brain. This is Matt Payne. Everyone say hello to Matt Payne. All right, so Matt is a very, very accomplished drummer, and not only the Christian and country world, he's also very knowledgeable about music technology, and he's gonna talk to us today about a brand new business that has been happening for 6 years.
Yeah.
6 years in the making, and now he's launched it in recent years, and he's gonna talk about that, and that really fits in with our theme of disruption of the music business, of the contemporary music business, whatever that is. It's the Wild West out there. And everyone say hello to Jim McCarthy. Jim McCarthy behind the board right there. He's our Ed McMahon. He's our muse. He's doing all things video and lighting. Jim, keep us on track. What are we doing today?
You know, first and foremost, congratulations, Mr. ACM winner. It's the end of the year. Well, you know.
Yeah, Jason Aldean. Congratulations to Jason Aldean and the whole camp for 2 in a row ACM Entertainer of the Year. Fantastic. You know what that means? When you get nominated and voted and you win for Entertainer of the Year, you got to go out and you got to entertain.
Exactly.
You got to go take the music to the people. You got to get on that bus. You're living in airports. You're backstage. Sometimes the catering is good. Sometimes it's
Most
not.
Most of the time it's not.
You know, but so Matt, you know, tell us, you know, you could just chime in on everything. You'd be a good sounding block, because I've just celebrated 20 years in Nashville.
Yeah.
And you've been here
really close. I'm like 18 or 19.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you've done so well. I'm so proud of you. You know what's really crazy is that sometimes I'll see you once a year.
Yeah.
Or twice a year. Sometimes I'll just completely won't see you for like 2 years, and you'll be like, dude, I'm working on this. I'm disrupting this. I'm playing with this person. I'm doing tracks for this person. So it's like, you know, there's 365 days in the year. You know, once you cross 40, it goes fast.
Oh, yeah.
It goes fast. So I don't even know how old you are. I will not ask you in public. Like,
no,
but
I'm not quite there yet, but I'm not too far away.
So Matt is younger than me. He's super, super successful. So he's got a lot of information to share. But yeah, but like every couple of years go by. And it always reminds me of a time like, you know, the first 10 years I was in Nashville, the hub in Nashville is Forks Drum Closet.
Oh, yeah.
You go to Forks, and there's session players that are in between sessions. They're hanging out. Then you got up-and-coming drummers. You got road drummers. You got drummers that come from out of town. They hear about this magical place called Forks Drum Closet. And it's just mixed, this kind of community. And I always have these vivid memories of going in there, and they're always so supportive. They go like, I'll be bringing up some sticks or some lug locks or whatever. Like, who are you playing with? What are you working on?
What are you
and
doing?
Like every, you know, the first couple years would be like every 2 months be like, oh, I'm working with this like kind of pseudo retro big band artist. Oh, I'm playing with this R&B guy. You know, I'm playing with this new band called Rushlow. We're like in a van down by the river. And like, oh, I met this guy named Jason Aldean. And so it's so cool. Like we have this amazing community in Nashville.
And I actually worked there when I first moved to town.
It's like a rite of passage.
Yeah. You know, I mean, it wasn't very long. I think I worked there like 6 months or something like that.
Yeah.
But yeah, I learned so much. I mean, even just like you would see the guys come in and you'd put faces with names.
You're like, oh, that's Steve Brewster.
Yeah.
I didn't know he came out of hiding.
And you'd figure out really quick. Right. I mean, at least for me, and I think I've always had this outlook on life, but you kind of like go, okay, I want to emulate that.
Right.
Like I want to like, yeah, I mean, just like the people who would come in and like be so sweet. I mean, I just remember like Trey Gray, like institution there.
Dude, Trey Gray was set the example for the nouveau hard-hitting drummer in Nashville.
Oh, gosh. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Because, like, here's this kid. He's full of, you know what, and vinegar, and he's from the heartland.
Yeah.
And he comes in, and he's got a massive backbeat over his forehead, and we're thinking to myself, wow, that's not your dad's Nashville.
No.
The rules have changed.
Absolutely. And that was, I mean, geez, I mean, he was like kicking. I mean, I moved to town in, what, 99?
Mm-hmm.
And he was like,
He was already on his way.
I mean, and then the Greg Morrows and Tommy Wells.
Tommy Wells, God bless him.
Yeah.
Tommy was always so supportive of me. When other people were like, oh yeah, that's that kid from North Texas, he's like overeducated, man, he was very, very supportive, you know? Yep. Just such a nice guy.
Yeah. And you kind of figure out, and then there's other people who in there who would come in there,
yeah.
And it wasn't the same way.
I know.
And
you're like, we'll avoid him like the plague.
Well, I mean, in a sense, you could just kind of go, okay, well, I hope that I don't come across that way.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I think that that's really, I think that that means more in 2017 than it ever has. I think, like, who you are as a human.
It's a people business.
Oh, gosh, yeah.
People make the world go round. I just got done from, we were just talking about it. I just was at the Omni Hotel, which is beautiful. You know, Nashville is the third fastest growing in the city in America right now. So these beautiful high-rise five-star hotels are going up.
Yeah.
So I did this cool little motivational speech. You know, I have this crash program. And it was this company called Hamilton Riker. And that one, they're like a staffing solutions company. And that was my message. It was like, you could teach people the hard skills, but it's the soft skills. Their ability to take direction, answer a phone, be the face of your company. Like...
Oh, yeah.
Be a human being is paramount.
Yeah.
That's first and foremost.
Absolutely.
Crazies. We love Nashville.
Yeah.
What was the story about, Jim, you wanted to talk about drummers in their first year.
Yeah. You're talking about Nashville being a five-year town.
Roughly. What do you think?
Oh, yeah.
And on average.
I thought about drummers in their first year or two turning down gigs.
Have you heard of this?
They're above them.
Oh, I mean, in the last 3 years.
What was your path coming up? You took everything, right?
Yeah, I made mistakes, and I hustled, and I would do anything. I mean, literally, like, just to get out there and, like...
Be like, oh, come audition in your basement?
Yeah,
I'll be there. And you learned all the songs, and you showed up, and it was free, and it cost you money.
Yeah, and those first couple years, like, the wave was, like... It was doing this, and then as you, like you said, the five-year thing, and then it kind of starts to, like...
You meet enough people.
Yeah.
To actually be able to connect the dots and maybe not have to do your day job. And my day jobs were, with my master's degree and all my experience...
Sure, which
and
I don't have any of that. I never went to college.
Hey, dude, you know, the funny thing is that there are no rules... 100%. To this business. It is the Wild West. So what I don't know what my education got me other than the fact that it got me a lot of time... In the trenches, playing a lot of different kinds of music.
Of course, yeah.
So you put that skill set together. You come here, and we're all competing for the same jobs. You know, I parked cars. I did data entry. I was a barista. I was a substitute teacher. I did construction. Yeah. And it was like, wow. Because I don't know. Is there more work now, 20 years later, or is there less? Or is it the same amount of work and more competition? We can't figure it out. Me and the Jim Rileys, we can't figure it out.
Well, I don't know. I mean, we talked about it even just before we kind of started this thing. Just like, I can't believe how high the competition is.
Tell us your story about
that. Oh, my gosh. Like, I was telling Rich earlier about I had just put a band together for an up-and-coming artist named Ryan Hurd, who actually just released an EP yesterday.
He's good, right?
He's amazing.
Right?
And you know his music because he's written songs for everybody and their brother.
Right.
Before... starting this path as an artist, but I put a band together for him, and like everybody who came in the door was great.
Like, so it was degrees of great.
Oh my gosh. And we're sitting there like we're not picking. It used to be, I mean, even when I was showing up for auditions, it would always be between like a couple of guys.
Right.
It would be a lot of mediocre, and then there'd be a couple of guys that would be like really in consideration.
Yeah.
This, I mean, it was to the point where it's like, okay, we were picking, everybody was great. Everybody could have done
this. These are drummers.
Drummers.
I got you.
And we were picking stylistically. Like, we ended up picking this kid and who just like plays like Dave Grohl. And he's just like a monster. And Ryan loved it. And it just works. But, you know, here's this young kid. Actually drove up from Atlanta. And he came recommended for some other people.
Right.
And just crush the audition.
The recommendation. See, that's huge. If for the listeners out there, it's like I always say, it's not, you know, who you know. It's who knows you.
It's who knows you.
So this guy had a multiple thumbs up. He was vetted.
Yeah.
And did he try to fit in stylistically with his music? Or he's just like, I'm Dave Grohl. This is what I do. Take it or leave it.
I think he kind of, he came in with, and that's the other tough thing about auditions is that, like, and this is what you always have to keep in mind when you don't get the gig. Even when you're so like, you walk out of the room, and you're like, oh my gosh, I played great. And you get that call 3 hours later, 2 days. Yeah, we went with somebody else.
We liked you, though.
Gutted.
Yeah.
And like, the reality is that you're guessing. you're literally going in there going, okay, I'm guessing that this is what they're looking for.
Yeah.
And sometimes you guess correctly.
And sometimes you
don't. And sometimes you don't. But that has absolutely nothing to do with your ability as a player.
Yeah, there's a gig with your name on it out there.
100%.
You just got to keep
trying.
Don't
give up.
Yeah, so Jim's thing is just like this. There are some people that are, they're qualified that I know in social circles.
Sure.
And they've been here 1, 2, 3 years, and they're being so picky. They're like, no, I'm not going to play Lower Broadway. I'm not going to play showcases. I'm not going to play with this person. They have very specific things in mind that they want to do. And part of me goes, well, they have a laser focus, and they're not changing. They're staying on their path, which there could be some to do. But I just didn't play the lottery. Yeah. I played with everyone.
Everybody.
I just almost feel like that is the way to go.
I mean, I played so many bad showcases. And it's like, I don't mean it. Like, you know, people would come in and it's like, man, when you're first into town, like, I just played to play. But then inevitably, and this is the thing, and you can attest to this because you've been in town for 20 years, and I'm yet to meet anybody who this isn't their story, is that I might have met a keyboard player on that gig who 6 months later got a great gig.
Yeah.
And 2 months into that, they were looking for another drummer.
Yeah.
It's basically my theory on hamburger versus steak clients.
Tell us what that's about, Jim.
Basically, I've talked about this in a video of mine on Jim McCarthy voiceovers. If you go to my YouTube channel, it's there. As far as pay scale, you never know. Even though the pay might be lower, it may not be the most high-profile gig, a steak gig. The hamburger gigs, you never know who you're working for and they might know.
And it's like, exactly. You're going to play a tips gig. Somebody walks in the room, hey, kid, come with me. Or somebody in that bandstand is going to end up being the next, you know, Uber producer or session leader or whatever. And so if you're just doing it, nothing bad can come from it. You're not booked. It's a Saturday night. You're not booked.
Yeah.
Go play. Work your craft.
Oh, and to even attest to that, I had a situation like midway through my career. I've been doing this. I'd made a living doing this for years.
Yeah.
And I was playing with an artist who had some voice problems. Tour canceled. Income cut off.
Right.
And I had to go back to the hustle, the grind, the $25 gigs, the $50 gigs, the writer's
after rooms. Having a drum tech and riding in a bus and tasting good food.
Like, and that was defining to the next phase of my career.
Right.
Like, it was 100% because it made me hungry. And that's another thing I see a lot of players do. They get a gig and it becomes their life. It's like, you are your own brand. Like, your brand is going to outlive anybody that you're playing with right now.
Yes.
Rare circumstances, you have to have a personal
brand. Branding is everything. We all know that there's these devices that you use to clean your ears. They're called Q-tips.
Yeah.
Right? There's only one word for an ear cleaning device. I'm sure there's other brands, Equate or whatever, but everybody knows Q-tips. So you need to be your own Q-tip.
So, even though it's technically a cotton
swab, it's an ear cleaning device.
Yeah.
You know, but so your story is so, so interesting. Tell us a little bit about making the transition from working drummer to an emphasis on using technology.
Yeah.
And now where you are today with your company, tell everybody about your company and how that's literally, we got to hang a little bit at the ACMs.
Yeah.
And we're talking about how the music business is being turned upside down and how the value that you can place on any particular skill set or piece of the industry is up to you. You set your dollar value on
100%.
Okay, talk about all that.
Yeah, so I'm going to kind of work forward and then work backwards. So what Rich is talking about is I have this company that we brand under. It's a play on words under my name, just called Built by Payne.
Perfect.
And it's basically what we do is we do everything from, if you're an artist that wants to play with tracks and you need somebody to either build hardware, we have got a guy who builds these beautiful racks. And we do all this programming, which is, I've been doing programming for 15, 16 years now.
Amazing.
That's kind of where it started. And then it started evolving into doing a lot of original content. We build segue music, we build intro tracks, we build, because now
people need all those things. Yeah, like, who does this? How can we find that guy? Yeah. They come to you.
Yeah, exactly. One stop and shop. And it's that thing where the shows are changing. So now what we refer to as playback or the tracks rig is now firing all the video content and the lighting content and all of this stuff. So even the nature of the show, everything is changing.
Who knew that a crazy bunch of Germans developing a software called Ableton would not only help DJs, would end up helping everyone.
Everyone.
In popular music.
And the thing about it is that if you're doing it, and it's a constant evolution. It's not what it was 15 years ago when we were, you know, simply syncing two mini disc players to get a stereo track.
Oh, I had to kick off the mini disc player. Oh, yeah.
But now it's really creative and musical, and you can get it. You can get the machine to actually, like, do all these different things. So it is a show.
Yeah.
And there is spontaneous moments in the show. But that's kind of what we're doing right now. And that started with me moving to town with literally my Honda Civic, a drum kit, and as much clothes as I could
fit. I had a Toyota pickup, one set of drums, and Cha-Cha the Black Cat.
Yeah, okay.
That's a similar story.
Yeah, I mean, it's the same thing. I mean, I just, like, moved here on a whim because I was like, oh, New York, LA, or Nashville. And Nashville just seemed safe.
Yeah.
I mean, I was a kid.
You're not, you know, as like, you didn't need a gun.
Yeah, it was like, it seemed affordable. I knew a couple people. My brother was at Belmont. But I started playing. I started gigging. I started getting to tracks early on because, A, it's always intrigued me. Technology has always been.
You got to love it if you're going to spend all that time in front of a computer.
Yeah, learning it. I mean, I remember, like, having these breakthrough moments of, like, learning how to, like, even in Ableton, like, how to stretch time and how to, like, drop keys and how to do all these unique things. But so I started playing drums and started to implement tracks. And also I wanted to make more money.
Right.
The band leader ran the tracks.
You double dip.
I wanted to be the band leader.
Yeah, it's like me playing percussion. Hey, you know, you play the tambourine, you get paid extra.
You know, I wanted to make more money. Yeah. And that went on for several years. And then, and I told this to Rich earlier, but I got Chris McHugh, who, if you don't know who he is, check him out, because he's
one of the most recorded drummers.
He's one of Nashville's best, in my opinion. Yeah. I mean, he's just crushing. He's been a huge part of my journey, but he, you know, around 2007, we had worked on a record together. I say that. He played most of it, and I played a couple songs.
Yeah.
We got to know each other. Brought me in to help him sort out some computer issues that they were having.
Right.
And that became defining of, like, oh, Matt's the tracks guy.
It was a defining moment for you moving forward in your...
Yeah, and also I was at a place that I was figured out over the next couple of years where I was looking at guys like Chris, and I was looking at guys like you, and I was looking at different drummers and going, man, I want their gigs. But it did kind of get to a place where I'm like, man, when I sit down behind a drum kit, I don't sound like Chris McHugh, which is fine. It's totally okay.
Totally fine. Because,
and I'm more musical now than I ever was, but I just, I wanted this, I was on this trajectory of, like, I was going to succeed in music. I didn't have a backup plan.
Laser focus.
I was going to succeed. I didn't know how, but I was going to succeed. So, started setting up tracks for a lot of people.
Yeah.
Started getting around, I started working with a bunch of baby acts out of a management company here in town that manages a ton of people. Consequently, they managed the Kings of Leon.
Yeah.
Got a call one day and wanted me to go out and drum tech, which is something I've always loved.
I remember this story. I was like, what, Matt's drum teching now?
Yeah.
And then you became a celebrity drum tech. It just seemed like it just happened.
Well, it was a thing, man. I just looked at, like, I took a step back, and I think most guys would go, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going
to tech. But you took it to high art.
They shut down. But what they don't understand is that, like, I looked at that. It took me a couple days to, like, go, yeah, I'm going to do this.
Mm-hmm.
But I looked at it and said, well, I'm going to position myself and meet people and be in circles going there,
right,
that I'll never get the opportunity to be around.
So Kings of Leon, one of the most popular rock bands in the world, and dare I say that you have a relationship with Harry McCarthy, right?
Paradise. Yeah,
and
he's awesome.
So somehow, next thing you know, you're under the stage all night long with Max Weinberg.
Yeah, taking care of Max. Yep.
So how long did you take care of Max with the Bruce Springsteen's?
5 years.
Where did this time go? What? Oh, no, 5 years?
Man, that's 7. That's 7 years of my life. I did almost 2 years of the Kings.
So, needless to say, Matt knows how to tune a drum.
I've tuned a drum or two. I've changed
and,
the head or two.
And you've been a guest at one of my camps,
yeah.
the Nashville Drummers Weekend.
Yeah, I think it was a great time doing
it. I think it was the second annual. It may have been the third. They're all starting to run together now. It's getting a little crazy. And Chris has been a teacher at my camps. Mm-hmm. And I know we have my fifth annual camp is coming up. First weekend of November, which is going to be really, really fun. And I have yet to hire the talent for that. But it's three 8-hour days studying with your heroes, breaking bread with your heroes.
Yeah.
And then at the end, you get to do a concert.
It's so cool.
At Douglas Corner, which is really fun. Because music education, I kind of went on a rant about this the other day. And Jim was like, yes, that's a great rant. But I basically just said, hey, music education is the best marketing tool you could ever have to sell for drums and percussion instruments. And drum shop owners, whether it be a chain or a mom and pop, need to have the world-class players come into their store and share their story.
Yeah.
And even
it's actually really sad to hear
it's dying.
Players talk about how clinics are going away.
And it's tough.
Just like, I mean, I remember seeing, Kenny Aronoff.
When you're excited, you're like
clinic.
That's the guy that played Jack and Diane. What? Yeah.
And now it's so funny. Like, he's like one of my closest friends.
Yeah.
So
you worked for Kenny too.
I've done some stuff. And honestly, like, we've done like little stuff here and there. And now it's like we just call each other like
send each other like 6 weeks, dirty tweets
and just inspire. Texts. I have a funny story about that with my mom being in the car actually, but that's a whole other story.
Mom, you're on speaker.
Totally, Kenny. Like, anyway, but no.
And Kenny taught at my camp too, and he's very approachable and so accomplished.
But he's like, man, he's got, people, they want to just look at the drumming. What they don't realize about Kenny is that, like, the reason why Kenny is still working on the top level is that when Kenny, the human, walks in the room, everybody plays better because he brings this
fire.
Energy. He brings this X factor.
Mm-hmm.
Are there better drummers than him?
You can't teach that.
Without question. But that's always the case.
Yeah.
It's rarely about talent.
The level of preparation and the self-discipline and the focus that goes into when you commit to a gig, whether it pays $5 or $5,000, you give it the same urgency. And that's
what he does. I mean, we've done... I've helped him like get a lot of his, speaking of technology stuff, I've helped him get a lot of his like paper charts and the digital, and I've done the same thing with Max.
Yeah.
Like I've got all his notes.
But what if the iPad dies or it crashes or the power surges?
It's going to, but it's a million times more reliable than you sifting through a,
I know, I'm still on paper.
Yeah. Well,
I'm carrying it. It's like a big giant book.
But if you were going to go do a gig, man, I mean, the idea of like, Kenny goes on and does those Bodine gigs. And it's like.
It's digital now?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So anyway, but I've helped, him. But he's that guy. Like, he walks in the room, his EQ, his emotional quotient, his ability to like walk in and assess the room and figure that out. Like, he's an amazing drummer. Right. But that's a given. Right. The given when you show
up is your drumming.
And even when you move to town.
Yeah.
Like, if you show up for an audition, people assume that you can play.
In a town like this called Music City,
you
have to bring the heat. And then it's going to come down to apples and bananas and, they're going to choose that flavor because all 100%. The flavors taste good.
Yeah.
So what's going to fit that particular thing? I'm lucky that I haven't had to do a lot of auditioning. I know I have friends on the West Coast and on the East Coast that they're with an artist for 6 months, a year, 2 years. They're constantly learning new material, constantly auditioning. I mean, it's just that I'm in that period right now when Kenny was with Mellencamp, where it was like a ride.
How long have you been playing with Jason?
18 years. It doesn't happen.
and how much of that has been on like a high, full-time high?
We haven't stopped touring since the end of 2004. So that's a 13-year period there, right? Well, and so
it's almost unheard of.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
And so, you definitely have this big gratitude for like putting a team together and you surrounding yourself with like-minded people. And that's a...
But it also says, that you have the ability to like... There's a lot of growing pains that happen over a 13-year period with a guy like him.
I mean,
like, you watch it expand.
And wives coming and going and stuff.
Yeah. But it's like you sit there and you go, you understand your place and your role and you figure it out. And that says a lot about the whole team.
And then just executing.
Yeah, because a lot of guys do, they come in, they start getting like, they start feeling like, oh, this is my gig. And they start, well, it's like, well, wait a minute. you know? Yeah. Well, it's still his name on the,
yeah.
you know, and you start, you understand your role, and I think that speaks volumes.
Yeah.
What you guys have been able to
show up and execute.
Yeah.
So what is, if somebody wants to get in touch with you, what's the best way?
I mean, honestly, probably through Facebook or Instagram.
Isn't that funny?
Yeah.
That's so crazy.
Yeah.
So you have a website, probably, right?
I actually don't, which is website. Hilarious. It's been my thing, man. I mean, it's like people say, like, oh, you know, how do you get these clients? And I've been blessed, man. I mean, I've gotten to work, like, some of the coolest, most creative stuff I've done, like, doing, like, working with Maren Morris and her team on the CMA performance with the Preservation Hall Jazz Band.
Wow.
And putting that arrangement together. Like, I mean, that's the coolest stuff I've ever gotten to work with. And right. she's such a talent.
Yeah.
And it's all just, you know, it's come from, like, building this reputation of, like, doing
reputation
great work.
Reputation precedes you, yeah.
And then then you align yourself with, I mean, yeah, like, a superstar talent like that. And it's like, you can do amazing things. But people always ask me, they're like, how do you get this work? Like, do you have a business card? Do you have a
You're
website?
You're going to get a million Facebook requests now, buddy.
I don't, because the reality is that, like, it's all about relationship. It's 100% about authentic relationship and just doing great work. Mm-hmm. And it's like, you know, even my story of how I got hooked up with her, it's like, it goes back like 6 or 8 layers. It goes back to like...
It's like a 7-layer bean dip from a party that went on 10 years ago.
Because you don't know. You don't
That's why you
know.
Can never be a prick.
Yeah, exactly. 100%. Yeah.
Yeah, take everything. Say yes more than you say.
I would say yes. I think I said yes to everything for the first 16 years. I'm going on year 20. So just in the last 4 years, I would say, oh, $25. Just okay music.
Yeah.
After 16 years, I earned the right to say pass. Because I might be able to do better things with the time that it would take for me to learn, set up my drums, go play with this.
Yeah,
you know
time,
what I mean?
Because time has...
Time has value.
Yeah, absolutely.
So let's talk about the disruption. And creating a financial model for your services.
Yeah. It's been interesting because I almost moved. So to back it up, before I started working for Bruce, I had finished my time with the Kings of Leon. I had decided that I wasn't going to go back. Got to work on a record and had a great time. And I have an amazing relationship with those guys even to this day. Nathan is just an awesome dude. And what a great drummer.
Great.
I mean, what a unique... Oh my gosh.
Style.
Yeah. Even if as a drummer, it's like everybody wants to like focus on the technicalities, which he is not a technical drummer. But like
an emotional drummer.
Yeah, but oh my gosh, like songs like McFearless and all these weird songs, like good luck playing that groove, buddy.
Right.
Good luck making it feel like that.
Right.
It's a band thing.
Right, it's a band
it's
thing.
You can't write that out on a chart and make it
feel
like
Well, like in like bands are so unique because if you take one member out.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah. Oh, and that band, like that's one of the few modern bands where literally you can't replace a member.
And Max Weinberg, how would you take that guy out of that symbiotic relationship with Bruce? I'm assuming they're inside each other's heads.
It's unbelievable. It's like nothing you've ever seen. Mm-hmm. And the way he just all night, you know, people like they're like, man, he looks kind of angry up there. I'm like, he's not angry. He's literally focused on
the 18-piece band.
All night. He never loses.
Max.
Oh, yeah.
Max is focused
on and
Bruce.
Even like on his kit, man, we have a video screen set up that so when Bruce goes behind him, he's watching Bruce on the kit.
Oh my God, that's amazing. It's almost like being a circus drummer. You gotta watch
three
rings.
Because you don't know when he's just gonna go pop.
Swap.
I mean, yeah, and he just, bam.
And that was like Ronnie Tutt and Elvis.
Same thing.
Right. And Ronnie, actually, I think the story is he started taking martial arts.
Okay, yeah.
To like learn,
yeah,
you know, body language and
stuff. Well, and you start to track.
Yeah.
It's like Anton Figg playing with Letterman. It's that same, it's show drumming. It's a lost art, unfortunately.
Yeah. Why do a backbeat here when it could be up here?
Yeah. Max is like, even like his kit is that like, you know, it's just a traditional kit. It's like 22, 13, 16.
Two crashes.
It's like a 17 and an 18, 20 inch rack, 14 inch.
It's small.
But it's not, and it sounds awesome. It's just we're in this era where everybody's like, I play 19 inch hi-hats. And I'm like, I hate
when I play
19
inch crashes.
Yeah, which is cool for certain things. Yeah. But for him, it's like, man, when you hear him smack that 17, it just works.
Yeah.
And it's got a home in that thing. And I think that. Yeah, anyway.
Sounds like you need a bunch of them down there below to pass up.
Yeah.
Sounds like that's small.
Yeah. but whatever.
It works.
He's awesome, man. I learned so much just about, like, even watching those, watching Max work from a, because, you know, Bruce does sound checks every day, which is a garbage term because it's just a rehearsal. He's not on the stage to make sure everything's working.
So actually, he loves to play so much. It's another reason to
get together. Well, yeah, because it's like, you know, he went, he's like, hey, I keep seeing signs for this song and this song and this song. And it's like, they work these songs up. They're rehearsing.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like every day.
Yeah.
Every day they're rehearsing. And to watch Max, like, musically figure it out and ask intelligent questions and, like, musically guide the band. And to be able to, I mean, rhythmically take stuff where Bruce can't, but he, like, can read his mind.
Yeah.
It's unbelievable.
I love it.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
And, like, how he wants to feel it and how he wants to, like, it's just, yeah. It's a symbiotic. It's a freaky thing.
I always thought Max had a day job. Like, when I first got introduced to the Bruce Springsteen band back in, like, 84 when
yeah.
he was in the dark, the video, it looks like he came off, like, he got up at work being an accountant.
Oh, yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah. But he's smart enough to be an accountant. He's crazy
he's
smart.
He's a lawyer, right?
Yeah, I think
he's... Does he have a law degree?
Yeah, he's got... I think so.
Law and music. Well, I guess there's a...
Yeah. He's like a real estate nutcase.
I love that.
I've learned so much about real estate from that guy.
I know. You've done... So, I mean, so you're a drummer turned... always a drummer. Once a drummer, always a drummer.
Yeah.
But now you're a serial entrepreneur. You've really got this business that is doing very well for yourself. You're looking into the future. And you've done... So you've... Very inspiring to me. So many amazing things with the money you've made. You've turned it into...
And a lot of that, honestly, man, is just like taking influence. Like you talked about Harry McCarthy earlier.
Yeah.
Like I call him Yoda. He's been such a huge influence on my life.
Yeah.
Max Weinberg's been such a huge influence on my life.
Mm-hmm.
And these people, it's like, yeah, because I tell people all the time, I tell young musicians all the time, it's not about the opportunity, it's about what you do with it.
Mm.
And that's so multifaceted. Like people get in, they get these gigs, and they just park it.
And if the universe is telling you to do something, take massive action right away.
Yeah, it's like if you get a big gig, I mean, it's like I see you do it. It's like you've got this great thing going on with Jason, but you've parlayed it into your own drumsticks and your own bass drum beaters and your book. Mm-hmm. And all these things are important to you because it's not about the end didn't stop at Jason Aldean.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You've taken this great opportunity.
Yeah.
And you've created more opportunity.
You got to create opportunity.
And you're
yourself.
Continuing to do it and you'll never stop. And I think that as you, when you look back at the guys who have the 30, 40, 50, 60 year careers, you keep finding these same
commonalities
over and over and over.
Discipline,
and over
hard work, inventiveness.
Do you think a lot of these guys look for the other opportunities to create more legs to the stool, more streams of income?
Well, I mean, I always say musicians are historically bad businessmen.
Yeah. Well, I mean, some people are just comfortable to stay within music, and I'm not straying too far. I'm almost like more like in the entertainment business. Just like, can I co-host that morning show? Yes.
Yeah.
Can I write a book? Yes, I'm writing two more. Can I act? Well, people might say he sucks, but I'm in class all the time and I'm learning. You know what I mean?
Yeah, so you might as well. You're still working and you're learning and you're pushing yourself. And you discover strengths along the way.
Mm-hmm.
And you discover, and it's like, and it's also, there's a huge part. It's like, who cares what people think?
Well, you got to get over that, right, Jimbo?
Yeah.
We talk about all the negative Nellies and the naysayers, and they are everywhere, and most of them just have too much time on their hand. They should be using that time where they're creating negative energy to actually create something special for themselves.
Yeah.
You know? Should we take questions?
I mean, one of the questions that we had was how do you balance, and I'm sitting there cycling through this here, I probably should have been more prepared.
Well, we're just having such a good time here, Crash.
We are, actually.
Actually, first of all, we've got winner of last month's bundle of sticks, the brick of sticks.
Yes,
dude. John Cardenas, 202.
Cardenas?
Cardenas.
Cardenas. Or is it Cardenas?
Cardenas?
I think that might be a Cardenas.
So I think that basically we need his address, and we need him to... let us know where to send the sticks.
Congratulations, John. Man, yeah, you're getting 12 pairs or is it 10 in a brick?
Of your sticks?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Not bad.
12 pairs of brick of sticks should hold you over for quite a while.
Yeah, unless you hit like us, and even if you do, you're probably going to be okay, because I get all sorts of feedback saying, dude, this is such a durable pair of sticks. I play in a metal band and I still have these things. So I think you're going to enjoy them. They're a good all-around drumstick, but and they're unique looking. I feel like people are like, dude, are those graphite sticks? No, they're not graphite sticks. They're just black sticks, man.
They're just coated in PVC.
Congratulations, man.
And also, I'm trying to think what else. I don't have anything else at the moment. But
well, I do remember one question being someone asked me, hey, what kind of marketing materials should I have when I move to town?
That's right.
And, you know, it's really funny. Like, some people like say, look, I don't have a business card. I don't have a website. You're ingrained.
Oh yeah,
in this world.
In the fabric, yeah.
Now, when I moved to town, I had a box of 400 cassette tapes that said "Rich Redmond, drums and percussion" with my phone number on it.
I had business cards.
Yeah, business cards, and then I had a little what you would call a press kit, which was basically just a bio and some, you know, literally press clippings from the college newspaper or something
right.
Just, and I was so ready to get connected. I was so impatient. And nowadays, everything is digital. You know, you've got. You know, you can have a website, your Facebook, your Twitter, all that. You can promote what you do. A YouTube channel. You know, if you're a drummer, you don't have a YouTube channel, it's probably, you know, if you can't beat them, join them. It's a really fast, effective way for people to see, wow, this is what this dude sounds like.
And everything's so affordable to do these days.
It's all free.
Free. Yeah. It just takes work.
Well, but even, like, to set up, like, to get a setup going where you can, like, record, like, pro-sounding drums.
Yeah.
Even for, like, your YouTube channel, like...
Just for your YouTube channel, and I'm actually sending files to people in Newfoundland and Tokyo, and it's like they're paying me not for like, well, I want you to get drum sounds from Ocean Way. I'm getting the drum sounds from Rich Way Studio, but they're paying for my energy, my passion, my enthusiasm, the space between the notes, all that stuff that maybe attracted them to me in the first place as a drummer.
Yep.
It shows up to their inbox, and most likely a lot of them with the way the kids are making today. They blast it with samples and do all sorts of stuff anyway. So I don't go, well, we're not in Ocean Way. No, we're in a 600-square-foot, man cave.
Yeah, totally.
One of the ways you get your questions on this show is I'm looking at them as you guys are asking. The ones that are going to attract my attention are the ones that really stand out, like this one from Cass McCullough.
Kind of splash symbols.
Hey, play. Cass.
Yeah, how do you walk the line between confidence, arrogance, and being humble?
Wow.
That's a good question.
Well, humility is something that you can do at all times. When someone thank you is such an important thing to just say constantly. Somebody opens a door for you. Somebody buys you a Starbucks. Yeah. Somebody hires you for a gig. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. It's magic to people's ears. Another thing that's magic to people's ears is their name.
Yeah.
Learn people's names as much as you possibly can. It's the most magical sound in the universe. And then when you actually get behind your drums or play with your band, that's where the confidence comes in.
Yeah.
And that allows you to receive the praise from people, and it's where you can continue to say thank you. Arrogance is, there's no room for that.
No, that never ends well.
That arrogance allows you to have a...
I've tried. I mean, I definitely...
A two-year career.
Early, you know, everybody makes those mistakes early in their career because they see these guys and they mistake confidence for arrogance.
Yeah, thanks, man. Actually, it's just a big love fest. We're all in this ever-changing industry.
It's like one of those things. Like, man, gosh, I hired Chris McHugh the other day. This was a couple months back. It was actually for the Grammys.
Now you're hiring your friends.
Yeah.
It's great.
But I hired him to come in and play this track. And he comes in, and he's got a very, like, distinct personality. Very confident. But the leadership... that his confidence brings to the table in a session.
Yep.
It's worth the amount of money he charges every time. He made everybody play better. He comes in the control room. He's in the track. He's like...
committed to that moment.
Yeah, he's
time.
Giving great feedback. He's receiving feedback and ideas.
Yeah.
So
give and receive.
Yeah, and he's just like... And he's got this overall, like, leadership. Like, leadership to me is confidence.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, if he came in and was just like, you know,
yeah,
whatever, just like yelling and, you know, getting all over the, you know, calling out everybody on the table, nobody wants that. Nobody's going to hire that guy back. Like,
occasionally I get called to like lead a session.
Yeah.
And it's fun because the drummer perfect leader. I mean, we're not the one that's behind the keyboards with the entire harmonic spectrum at our fingertips.
No.
But we can come in and we know what we want. We can ask for things. We can make suggestions. And then when it comes time to count off the song, we know that in Nashville, oh my God, we got to do what? 3 to 5 songs in 3 hours?
Yeah,
like, one, two, like, you know, you bring it, like, let's go, guys. And more than anything, a session leader is, like, leading with that confidence and keeping everybody on task.
Yeah.
You know, because when, you know, we get into the room, we're all cutting up, we're drinking our coffee, we're like, what's going on with the kids? Like,
yeah.
How's the boat? You know, yeah. And we're just like, you know, someone's paying for us to get the 5 songs in the 3 hours.
When, again, they hired you because, and they hired you with the idea that you can deliver.
Yeah. You better deliver.
Like, that's you know, that's the prerequisite.
You can't have a bad day.
Oh, my gosh. That's why, I mean, that's one of the things that got me into, like, the programming stuff is I early on, I was like, I don't want to play sessions. I don't love playing sessions in the traditional Nashville way. Mm-hmm. That's not my thing.
I mean, the time is money thing.
Yeah, because okay. I would shut down. I, like, creatively would just, like, because, I mean, yeah. In a lot of respects, especially when you're first doing it, it's like somebody's holding a gun to your head. Like, play.
Let's go.
Go. Here we go. Go.
Yeah.
You know, well, you didn't get that push. Like, in your
on the anaphore going into the bridge.
And I would just, like, I would just crumble, man. And, but one of the things that I did is I recognized that.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't keep going back. I recognized the fact that, like, that's not my strength.
Mm-hmm.
What is your take on people who look at what guys in the studio do, playing backbeats 2 and 4,
yeah.
The money beats, and they're basically throwing the flaming darts going, oh, anybody could do that?
Yeah, that's a lie.
Well, how come they're not doing it?
Yeah.
Because right. First of all, it's like, yeah, if you could do that, that's one thing.
Yeah.
But you're not willing to pack up the family and risk everything and move to Nashville and swim with the sharks and actually put your money where yeah. Your mouth is. That's a big one. That's a big
whole
difference.
Other thing. And I mean, again, like there's this, we kind of talked about it earlier. There is a, if somebody, well, it always makes me laugh, man. People don't know what they don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But I love that just like that overall lack of awareness of like, oh, anybody could do that. It's a beautiful statement that just describes so much lack of like, it's like if you watch, I mean, who's like some of the great, even like guys who have played Masters, they really do a ton of demos, like Steve Brewster,
mm-hmm.
And like, yeah. I mean, there's like a handful of guys. To watch those guys go in and cut, you're mm-hmm. just like, I've watched Steve Brewster go in and like, he'll go in, cut the song, first pass every time, and then while the guitar players are playing a solo overdub, he's got this percussion thing, or he's creating a loop on his drum cat, or he's like,
yeah.
He's so dialed in and so fast. It makes it sound so good.
It's a cottage. There was about 7 or 8 years where I was doing 2 or 3 of those a day where you're playing my record was 21 songs in one day.
Yeah.
That's 7 songs three times a day.
That sounds miserable.
And that's just, you're just executing. And then you say it. Yeah. When the guitar player is picking up their second pass, you're knocking out a tambourine pass or a shaker to bring to glue it together. Amazing learning
yeah.
experience.
Yeah.
But I can't imagine that kind of a grind for 40 years.
No, so, my brother does. He's a session guitar player.
Yeah.
I mean, he like every day. It's what he does.
Really?
He hasn't toured for almost a decade.
Do I know your brother?
He's a great guitar
Holy
player.
Holy cow, it's crazy.
Yeah. Yeah.
What else, really Jim? How are you know, we can go on for hours with this. Where
I don't know. Nick Farrell, for those who can't necessarily relocate to Nashville, what kind of advice can you offer to stretch your name up there?
Ooh. Silence falls. Must be present to win, right? I mean, it's like...
I mean, in a sense, I mean, you've got to be in some level of a music community. Like, there's a lot of guys coming out of Atlanta right now.
Mm-hmm. That's where he's from.
Oh, it is?
You got the Atlanta Institute of Music. There's 35 television shows that are being shot in Atlanta right now. Historically, there's an amazing R&B/programming hip-hop scene there.
I might get shot for this, but church is big business there. Like, a lot of guys come out of the
church.
Like, North Point Church. And these are, like, big production.
They get paid to play church.
Yeah.
They get paid well to play in a church.
And it's pretty cutthroat because, again, the competition's super high. And it's like yeah. These guys, like yeah, they get paid. And there's a handful of them in Atlanta. Atlanta's kind of a mecca for that. Mm-hmm. And they're all networked. And a lot of those guys
end up with big pop acts, too.
Yeah. Big pop acts.
They move to Los Angeles, and then they're the ones getting the the Britneys and the, those gigs.
Yeah. And they've started to really infiltrate Nashville as well. Like Christian Pascal, who plays with Maren Morris, who's just awesome. You've never seen him play.
He's the drummer?
Yeah, he's ridiculous. Okay. His pocket is like you could take a nap in it.
Amazing.
Yeah, I mean, and again, the level of competition. Here's this guy who kind of came out of nowhere. But he came from that whole scene.
Yeah.
And he knows all these different styles and knows how to play and knows how to, like, interact with other people and knows how to, like, all these things.
Right.
And everything matters. And that's the other thing, too, man, for, like, players like this guy, even. It's like, man, one of the biggest mistakes that you make is that, like, I made this mistake when I moved to town. Like, we're taught to put drumming or guitar playing or whatever your instrument is, we're taught to put it here, and everything else kind of lives down here. And when you get in professional settings, like, everything levels out. So your craft and your personality and your look and your bus hang and everything is here, where it, you know, we're just like hot, like, oh, you should see my chops, or you should see I can blow polyrhythms all day. And it's like, like, great, that's laughing. Fantastic. Yeah. Nobody cares.
Yeah.
Not to say that you shouldn't work, because doing that stuff makes playing 2 and 4 that much easier.
Yes.
But
over-educate yourself.
Yeah. That's a good lead into the next question that kind of circles back around to Kenny Aronoff. Funny story about him, back when I was living in Vegas working for CBS Radio, we got the opportunity to go see Michelle Branch.
Yeah.
Kenny was backing her up at the time.
Yeah.
I knew who he was,
right?
Because I'm a drummer. But the bottom line is that when she came out on stage, and he came out on stage, he got just about as much applause as she did. There were people in the audience that knew who he was.
Sure. Yeah. He like transcended. He's got a strong personal brand.
Yeah. But even him, man, like, if you sit down and talk with him, like, he went through a transition period. Like, he talked about, I mean, even we've talked about, like, how pivotal, like, his relationship with Melissa Etheridge was. Because Melissa sat him down and was like, listen, man, you got to think about your fashion. You got to think about all of this stuff, man. Your drumming is awesome. Your energy is the best. But if you want to continue to stay relevant, the dude's in his 60s.
He's 64, yeah.
Yeah. Crazy. If you want to stay relevant, you have to start thinking about
good
this
for
stuff.
Melissa. That's
and
amazing.
He's and being a smart business guy, he's embraced that stuff. And boom, all of a sudden his career has another 20.
Another leg.
And not a short leg. Like, yeah. It's another, like, 25 years.
Yep.
So
amazing. Randy Perdue asks...
Hey, Randy.
Hey, Rich. Tell why John Mellencamp albums are your favorites.
Oh, yeah. Everyone was like, because we were talking the other day, and I was like, get these two records. And you would probably agree with me, as Desert Island Records. Scarecrow,
yeah,
and The Lonesome
awesome.
Jubilee.
Yeah.
Well, and The Lonesome Jubilee was 15 years before the Nashville boom. So Nashville ended up sounding like the Lonesome Jubilee 15 years after that.
Yeah.
It was like seriously foreshadowed. Who would have known records, to come from, man, a little town, Seymour, Indiana, you know?
And Scarecrow, man.
And the way those records were recorded, the drums were massive. And there was, you know, heartland storytelling, yeah, which is, I'm lucky. I feel like I'm playing with one of the best artists in Nashville right now, because he cuts really good songs, yeah, that tell stories.
Yeah.
You know, there's the occasional song where you're just like, well, we got to put this out because it's a nice summer song.
Sure.
You know what I mean? It's breezy. There's a lot of meat in the storytelling, which relates to what I like about a lot of my favorite, you know, songwriters. Your Mellencamps, your Lucinda Williams, your Sean Colvinses, your Steve Earles. You know, classic Americana storytelling, you know. I love it. I'm a sucker, yeah, for that. If I was a great singer, I would be an Americana singer.
Yeah,
it'd be totally amazing. But I'm not. So you have to know your strengths.
100%.
You know, so what do? I play drums and I try to make other people's songs come to life.
Yep.
And I even experimented for 4 years on having a publishing deal, and I focused on writing songs for 4 years. And it was great because I actually got to go in and be behind the glass and have the Steve Brewsters and the Eddie Bears and those guys,
yeah,
play drums on my songs that I wrote, which is a whole other cool experience,
yeah,
to see that come to life.
Yeah.
So the longer you stay in Nashville, I will just say, you'll end up doing things you thought you would never do. Producing records,
yeah,
writing songs, writing books, learning new technologies, starting your own company.
Yeah. And I tell people all the time, I mean, I look back at my career, and even this, it's like, smartest thing I ever did was put the drumsticks down.
Wow.
Well, I mean, a lot of that kind of plays in with people who have a laser focus coming in that I want to do this. Maybe they're not meant to do that. Maybe that's their self-awareness is off.
Well, yeah. I mean, I love drums. I walked in this room today and I see the drum kit and I'm just like
let's go. You want to sit down?
I love drums. Yeah. And I do. And I still love drums. Yeah. And I love picking, you know, like every rehearsal I run, I'm just like, oh, what kind of, you know.
You're out in the hallway. The kid goes to the bathroom and you're on there playing 50 Ways to Leave a Lover.
Yeah. Yeah.
But you know what? Jim will say, like, you know, maybe sometimes you just have to tell somebody, hey, maybe this isn't for you. And I couldn't do that. I'm the kind of guy that's like, you know what? If you want to do this, dude, just keep trying. Like,
yeah. But at the same, there's everybody with the entrepreneurial bent that's going on right now. They all want to be a CEO, but maybe you could be a number two or number three or number four in a company, and that's still okay.
It's still okay. You
know? Oh, right. Completely okay. I mean,
you're still going to drive an
Audi.
You
need those people. Yeah. Exactly.
If you're number two or number three, you're still going to drive an Audi.
100%. So I think for a final question, we'll go with Amy Clark. No, actually, no. Karen Bushy Lucier. I hope I'm not.
Karen Luzier.
Luzier.
Lucier. She'll answer to both. She's awesome, though.
I'm assuming this is a question for Matt. Do you feel that your Christian high school upbringing helped guide you in life toward your success?
She did research on you. Look at you, Karen.
How did she know that?
Karen does her homework. Karen has hosted me for about 5 drumming events in Connecticut. She is so sweet. Thanks
for
tuning
in. Wait, what was the question one more time?
How do you feel that your Christian high school upbringing helped guide you in life toward your successes?
I mean, 100%.
We ended up playing in Christian music.
I did, and also, like, I mean, private education was one of the greatest blessings that I got early on. A blessing I didn't even recognize until probably 10 years after.
So having a focus group of kids that were...
Well, yeah. Well, I mean, right. I got to play all the time.
Right.
Like, I mean, I got to play and just be around music. I mean, 6-7 days a week.
Yeah.
Like... Yeah. And again, you talk about that, like, circumstance. And even what I'm doing now, and what people don't understand is, like, dude, I'm taking however many years, we could just say 20 years of experience, and I'm passing that experience on. That's all I'm doing.
Right.
I'm taking these artists who are blowing up on a viral stage and going, like, hey, let's put this set list together. Because you don't know how to, like, pace and let it breathe and where to, like, introduce the band and where to talk about your single and how to talk about
so
your
really
single.
Built by Payne is a full service consulting company where you're saying, we're going to build you your walk on music, your walk off on me, we're all your tracks, we're going to put your band together, we're going to train your band, we're going to put your set list together, we're going to tell you what parts to walk to on, what, when to talk to the audience, what to say, basically media training, dance, choreography, musical, everything to put a high level show together.
100%.
One stop shopping.
Because you work with these guys.
Is that brilliant or what?
Yeah.
That's really, so if people want to look, find you on the Instagram, is it just your name?
Yeah. Well, it's just Built by Payne.
Built by Payne, Payne.
Exactly.
And then on Facebook, you just your name, Matt Payne.
Yeah.
Two T's. Fantastic.
Yeah.
Right on. Well, how about that?
I actually think you linked me on Facebook, so yeah.
Yeah. How about that for a first guest?
There you go.
Yeah, episode 4, crushing.
You can still get your brick of sticks by liking and sharing and subscribing to your YouTube page.
Yeah, my YouTube channel, guys and gals, youtube.com/RichRedmond, R-E-D-M-O-N-D. I've been populating this thing for 10, 11, 12 years with lessons, behind the scenes footage, advice on how to cultivate a career, and cool, like, footage with the camera behind me and 80,000 people in the fire. And if that kind of stuff motivates you, watch it and then go practice and live my dream. You could do it. You could do it with follow through. So I would love for you to check out my YouTube channel. And then, of course, on all the socials, it's just my name, Rich
Redmond. I think if we hit 5,000 subscribers, we're at 45, 55 right now.
Yeah.
By May, I think you'll give something big away. I just don't know what that is.
Yeah, you know, we've got a lot of support. There's a lot of fun things out there. The Black Sheep Beater from DW, the Fundamentals of Drumming book from Modern Drummer and Hal Leonard, the Sticks from ProMark. I'm writing 2 books as we speak right now with co-authors, one of which is about how to navigate the Nashville music business. So many of the things that we're talking about are going to be in that book with with solid advice from tastemakers in the industry, like your Justin Niebanks and your So it's a perfect time to have for a resource like that. So if I can ever get it done. So thank you guys so much for tuning into episode 4. of pick Rich's brain. And I think what we're going to do is we had a really cool idea of coming up with not PBR, but PRB. We're going to make some coffee mugs. We're going to make some shirts. How about that? I heart PRB, pick Rich's brain. If you want to send us any questions, just be sure to use the hashtag pick Rich's brain. And we're not locking into a schedule right now, but Jim is the man, but he's a very busy man. But usually 3 or 4 days after this Facebook Live post, you can find this podcast on my website, richredmond.com, on Stitcher, on Google Play, on iTunes, and the video version as a webisode on my YouTube channel. Thanks again for tuning in, and we'll see you for episode 5 soon.